क्या बात Welcome back to this episode of Mood India. In our last episode, we talked to these two accomplished artists and we discussed sitar. Last time we talked about the physical structure of sitar, its history, a little bit about the building blocks of sitar playing, and rag, the concept in Indian classical music. If you missed our last episode, doesn't matter. This time we are going to talk about the structure of a concert, which is going to be equally interesting, if not more. For the benefit of the tuners who are coming to this episode for the first time, let me introduce you to the artists. We have Prasad Jogalekar on sitar.
Hello.
And Prasad started his sitar education from his parents in his childhood. And after that, he went on to learn from Mr. Sachidanand Phadke from Pune. And then he came to his main guru, the great Ustad Abdul Halim Jafar Khan Sahib. Now he also takes guidance from a very well-known sitar artist,
Ustad
Shahid Parvez. On tabla, accompanying Prasad is Abhinay Padhye.
Hello.
Abhinay is another accomplished artist from the Bay Area. And he started his learning from Sri Nana Mule of Mumbai, that's Bombay. Afterwards, he went on to learn tabla from Pandit Bhai Gaitonde. And after coming to the North America, he's continuing his tabla learning under the tutelage of the great tabla maestro, Pandit Shapan Chaudhary. Let's come back to the topic that I wanted to discuss today. We are going to talk about the structure of a sitar concert.
That's right.
So where do you start?
So last time we had a look at various aspects of sitar alankars or sitar ornaments and different sitar styles in the history. And as the instrument developed more and more degrees of freedom and it became more and more versatile, the playing technique also changed and it turned from an accompanying instrument into a solo instrument. And as a result, to suit the structure and the nature of the instrument and the types of sounds you can produce from the instrument, there is a certain style that every professional sitar player follows mm-hmm. when he or she presents a rag. And that style consists of you can break up a performance in a few different parts mm-hmm. based on the position of that particular piece mm-hmm. in the overall concert. And a concert or a particular raga rendering begins with something called alaps.
Alap. Mm-hmm.
So alap is basically a more meditative approach to the rag. Mm-hmm. It actually brings out, it's a reflection on the rag when there is what's present is only the notes, the rag mm-hmm. and the mood that the rag creates. The percussion element hasn't yet entered the concert. Mm-hmm. So that's more of a reflective phase where you elaborate a rag, you find out the personality of the rag, or the artist dwells onto that rag, the artist tries to bring out the mood, the impressions, the overall expression that the artist has in his or her mind and brings out the personality of the rag.
So is this the most free form of the entire part of the concert? Is that fair to say?
It's free in the sense that the artist has complete liberty to elaborate, but it's not in the sense the framework is still there.
Right.
The grammar rules are still there, and the rules of the game cannot be violated.
Okay. Can you show some example of how alap goes?
So I played Kirwani to begin with, and that defines the notes. You might have found some familiarity with, say, a D minor concerto or something. That's because that's basically Kirwani. And you can see some similarity at an abstract level. However, in a proper concert, a proper sitar concert where a rag can take up to an hour, the sitar player has 15, 20 or even more minutes to elaborate the alaps, to get comfortable with the rag. And in fact, to get to present the artist's impression of the rag at that point in time, and at that following the thought process that exists in the artist's mind at that time. So you hear the same rag performed by the same artist at different times, it's going to sound different.
Or maybe the same artist at different times.
Yes, the same artist at different times or different artists at the same time or whatever combination, it's going to sound different. That's because the artist has a complete freedom to elaborate.
Right.
And the only rule is you have to stick within the notes of the rag. So for example, so I'm trying to create some framework when I played that. We'll go into that when I play Rag Kirwani in more detail, but I'm establishing certain notes, certain patterns that I'm going to use repetitively, certain framework that I'm going to build on. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of building different pieces together and kind of constructing something piece by piece, and you're setting the background for that, you're setting the backdrop for that. When you play the alaps, you're setting the whole context.
Right.
And even somebody who doesn't follow the grammar of the rag, he or she can tell that these pieces fit together and they're part of the same rendering, they're part of the same performance, and they're not disjoint.
Right.
Because rag, alaps logically lead to jod, they logically lead, alap and jod together logically lead to the gut. So it all depends on how the artist wants to develop the flow, but it's really the flow of the rag that demands all these different pieces. So there is an alap piece and there is jod piece and there is gut piece when the percussion enters the picture.
Got it. And the next part is jod.
Yeah. So jod is usually played after, it's always played after alaps.
Mm-hmm.
And but some gharanas don't emphasize the jod as much as some other gharanas.
Mm-hmm.
However, it means that there is no percussion, however you have a beat. So there is a time element that enters. And you have to explore. It gives you a different perspective, because now you have an implicit beat and it creates a different beauty because the time element is there. For example, the tabla is not playing at this point. Tabla is still not there. Okay. So there is some beat to it.
So next part is gath when tabla comes in.
Yes.
Right. And you mentioned there is a slow piece which is called vilambit.
Yes.
And there is a fast piece which is called drut.
Yeah. Drut.
And so now you have actually tabla accompanying and there is kind of a dialogue going on.
Yeah.
Is that the so how much time is allocated to gath?
So it's hard to tell, but typically, if you take a sitar rag, a complete rag presentation for an hour, you might say alaps would take about 20 minutes, mm-hmm. and then jod would take about 10 more minutes, mm-hmm. and then vilambit might take about 15 to 20 minutes, and the rest of it will be taken by the drut part of it, and last few minutes will be taken by the jala, which is the climax point, the crescendo. Mm-hmm. But before you reach that, you have to go through all of this that leads up to the climax. So there is optional jhala that's played after the jod as well.
Mm-hmm.
So there is a different kind of jhala, sometimes referred to as thok jhala, which is played after the jod, but that's optional. And some people think that the crescendo should be reserved for the end and it should not take up some space in the middle. However, that's purely subjective. There is nothing that prohibits an artist from including a jhala after the jod.
Right. So shall we have an example of gath? Maybe 30 seconds.
Why don't you discuss briefly about what you're going to play on tabla? Say, for example, the teen tal to which this gath is
so the gath,
set to.
Gath is always accompanied by tabla.
Yes.
And we are going to have a whole episode on tabla, so we won't go into details of tabla. But Abhinay, you are going to play trital for this gath, right?
Right. So this gath is in teen tal, which is a 16-bit composition, and it goes something like this. Dha din din dha dha din din dha dha tin tin ta ta din din dha dha.
Can you play it for us so that?
Sure.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 1.
So within that framework of beat now, there is a certain part that is fixed. The gath part is fixed. The manja and antara parts are fixed. However, vast majority of the parts that I'm going to play on sitar would be improvised.
Mm-hmm.
And as I mentioned the last time, improvisation is part and parcel of any North Indian classical music presentation. And it takes one more dimension when the beat enters the picture.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing to note is improvisation still follows the rules of the rag. So improvisation is not to be taken as an antonym of classicism. It's all a part of the same structure.
Mm-hmm.
Improvisation has its own place. In fact, it has the most important place,
mm-hmm.
in representation of a rag. So I'll probably do some alaps first.
Okay.
Then I'll play a brief jod, which you already have seen in my previous example. And then I'll move on to a gath called vilambit, which we did not play last time. But this gath is set in a slow tempo,
mm-hmm.
so we'll elaborate in that beat, and the last part will be the faster paced gath.
Great. Now, before we go into it, you had a very beautiful quote
Felix,
which talked about music.
Yeah. So I have a quote by Felix Mendelssohn,
mm-hmm.
And he says that the emotional content of a piece of music cannot be translated into words, not because music vigor or it's indefinite, but because it's so exact that it cannot be defined by anything so ambiguous as language.
It's and beautiful.
That applies to improvisation, that applies to Indian music, that applies to any music.
And that kind of takes away any reason for talking more about anything. Let's get into the presentation you wanted to make. This is Rag Kirwani.
Thank you.
क्या बात है,
क्या बात।
ये बात
Thank you.
Thank you for being with us in this episode of Mood India. This was a two-part interview, up close and personal, with Sitar. Hope you enjoyed it. Hope we can keep bringing you such programs based on Indian music, dances, and other performing artists. So long. What about it?